Hey guys, I hope you're doing very well, and in today's video I'm going to be explaining why it's very important to take time to study individual face elements when you are getting into drawing faces more realistically. So in the last video we were talking about face proportions and starting to draw faces with correct proportion and location of facial elements. But after you have practiced that and you have that down, I think it's very important that you take your sketchbook out and make time to practice eyes, noses, lips, ears, hair, and all of these things that are really going to help you make believable and realistic portraits. I am going to be sharing with you how I go about creating my grayscale watercolor eye studies, and I'm also going to share with you 5 very important things to keep in mind when trying to achieve realistic looking eyes. And also guys, before we move on to anything else, I'd like to very quickly mention that even though maybe you're not intending for your art style to be very realistic looking at the end, it's very important for beginners to understand and study how things actually look like in real life so that all of these things give you a solid foundation that you can later on move off of if you desire. Later on, you're gonna be able to distort them however you'd like, but it's very important to learn the rules and study the rules before you go off and modify them. It's really important to make time to study facial elements individually because each one of them comes with its own set of difficulties. Something that I really recommend and something that I do myself is collecting 3 to 5 different close-up images of whatever facial feature I'm studying at the time and getting them in a few different perspectives and with a few different lighting styles. And using these images, make time to really observe the tiny characteristics of each facial feature, try to recreate it in your studies, and also notice the different types of forms that they can have and the different types of shadows that they can create. And I promise you that if you take time to do these individual studies, the moment that you try to actually draw a complete portrait, it's gonna be so much easier for you. You're gonna notice that you work a lot faster and the overall outcome is gonna be so much better. I noticed my portrait drawings started improving so much when I actually took the time to sort of dissect each part of the human face and study it individually. Moving on to how I personally like to do my facial feature studies, I like either doing these in regular pencil or either in black watercolor or ink. And I really find it useful to create these studies in grayscale or in monochromatically, because this will really allow you to focus on values and not worry about color yet. So focusing on values means that you're gonna be able to really work on and practice discerning what areas are lightest and what areas are darkest and what areas are mid-tones in each individual facial feature. It's very important for you to understand that values, in a way, are more important than color, because by placing values, by learning how to place values appropriately, you're gonna be able to create a believable sense of form. So after I have collected my 3 to 5 different images that I'm gonna be working with, what I do is I use a pencil to very lightly draw the most important shapes that you see in the picture. So I draw the shape created by the eye, basically where you see the eyeball and the tear duct. And I also like doing the line created by the fold of the eyelid. And I also make a general shape of the eyebrow. Aside from that, I also like to draw the iris and the pupil. And then once I finish with my initial outline drawing, I set my pencil and my eraser aside and I take out my watercolors. And I'm going to be using my black and some water to create at least three different values using black. So this means that I'm going to create a little puddle of water with a little amount of black to create my very lightest value. And then I'm going to create a middle value using a less amount of water than before and with more amount of paint. And then my darkest value is going to have even more paint than the other two with a less amount of water. And obviously, as I move on with the process, I start creating more values. But having three will at least give me something to start off with. And just as a quick note, if you don't have very much practice using watercolors yet, I really recommend that you do your studies using pencils because that's the main focus right now. Right now you should focus on studying the eye and not on practicing watercolors. They are two separate things. Once those things are done, I take a moment to really, really observe the picture and I try to pinpoint where the very darkest areas of the eye are. So obviously the pupil is completely black. So this is almost always going to be one of the darkest areas when creating an eye study or a drawing or a painting. And so it's gonna be the pupil and try to see which other areas are pretty dark in the eye. A lot of artists start their eye drawings by filling in the pupil. Just make sure that you leave any areas in the pupil that may have a light reflection upon it. It's very important that you look at your picture and notice these tiny white light reflections upon the eye that are usually somewhere in the pupil and the iris, and leave these areas completely white as much as possible, because these are what are going to create the effect of the eye being moist and reflective, and this is gonna help it look a lot more realistic. Continue placing your values little by little. Don't rush. Make sure that you're looking at your picture continuously and that you're trying to replicate what you see there, not what you think an eye looks like. If you decide to do this with watercolors the way that I did here, you're gonna have to allow your layers to dry. So I recommend doing at least three at a time so you can jump around between them as you allow them to dry. Two important things to have in mind throughout the process is that the eyelashes should be left until the very end. Make sure that you use a very thin paintbrush, probably the thinnest one that you have around. And one other thing is that to create natural looking eyebrows, I recommend creating them with three different values. So I always create them with at least three different layers, allowing each one to dry in between. Use a very, very light value to create your first layer and actually trying to make a hair-like effect with your paintbrush. And then let that dry and create the second value for your second layer and go on creating the hair-like effect. And then once that is dry, create your darkest layer and go ahead and create that hair-like effect again. So that's it, guys. That's all in terms of my personal sketching process. And to finish this up, I'm gonna give you my final five tips to have in mind when you are creating these types of facial feature studies. Some of these I already mentioned throughout my explanation of my process, and others I have not. Number one, use a photographic reference or a life reference. Practice your observational skills and try to replicate what something looks like, not what you think it looks like. Tip number two, what everyone calls the whites of the eyes are not really completely white. So this area that is actually called the sclera should not be left completely white. Observe your picture and notice the shadows within this area. Usually the eyelid causes a certain amount of shadow. And also keep in mind that the eyeball is an orb. So usually, not always, but usually, in your picture, you're gonna be able to see that there is some sort of shadow within the whites of the eyes, in the outer corners of the eyes, or close to the tear duct. Make sure that you notice these shadows and you apply them with a very light value within your painting or your drawing so that you are able to create a realistic looking eye. Tip number three, it's important to have in mind when you're doing the eyelashes that natural eyelashes are not perfect, so don't try to make them look like cartoon eyelashes. Some eyelashes are gonna be shorter than others. Some of them are going to be pointing in different directions or clustered in different ways. So sometimes you may see like two or three grouped together and maybe one of them is gonna be all by itself and then another little cluster of another little amount of eyelashes and so forth. So don't try to make them all uniform or all with the same distance from each other or anything like that. Eyelashes are not perfect. Try to create them using different values. And this is super important and something I struggled with so much in the beginning. Really make a point to not oversaturate your eyelashes. Tip number four is going to be something that I actually already mentioned before, and it's to protect and leave the whitest reflections on the eyeball completely white as much as possible. If you're using pencil and you smudge this area by accident, just make sure that you use an eraser at the end to lighten these areas. If you have a very thin eraser, like for example, I got through Amazon the Tombow Mono Eraser, those come in very handy when creating these final reflections at the end. I'll make sure to leave the link below for that product in case you're interested, and all of the other art supplies that I use here as well. And my very final tip is actually something that should be applied whenever you're trying to create any sort of realistic looking artwork. And it is to avoid using or leaving behind any obvious visible lines. Keep in mind that when you're trying to achieve realism, the different areas within your drawing are created by subtle changes in value, texture, or color if you're using color. But there are never outlines the way there are in cartoons. So, whenever possible, try to avoid leaving behind any obvious, thick-looking lines. In the case of the eye, somebody could argue that the crease formed by the eyelid above the eyeball could be referred to or seen as a line. But in that specific case, you should try to see what part of the line is darker and what part of the line is lighter, so that you don't make it the same thickness or the same strong value all the way across the line from one end to the other, if that makes any sense. So that's about it for this video, guys. I really hope that it was helpful and that it inspired you to go on and study some individual facial elements. If you liked it, go ahead and give it a thumbs up. Comment and subscribe if you'd like to see more of this type of thing next week. Don't forget to check out the information and the links I'm gonna leave for you below. And that's it. See you next week. Bye!